Government business, notice number one, anniversary of child sex abuse national apology.
And I call the Prime Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I move that the House commemorate the anniversary of the national apology to the survivors and victims of institutional child sexual abuse. Mr. Speaker, 3 years ago tomorrow, this Parliament, on behalf of all Australians, offered an unconditional apology to the victims and survivors of institutional child sexual abuse. Our national apologies have always been days of reckoning. Those days of reckoning have become, importantly, part of our national story. The apology to the stolen generations, an apology for the racism, cruelties and injustices inflicted on our First Nations peoples. The apology for forced adoptions, an apology for the shame and the stigma and the brutality that forcibly split parents from their children. The apology to the forgotten Australians and former child migrants. An apology for the unconscionable cruelties experienced by children removed from their families and placed in institutional homes. The apologies reflect our acknowledgement of our failures as a people. As a liberal democratic people, we aren't afraid of our history, nor do we recoil from engaging with terrible truths. Truth was always at the heart of the apology to victims and survivors of institutional child sexual abuse. And this is what the Royal Commission into Institutional Responses to Child Sexual Abuse, initiated by Prime Minister Gillard, was all about. With thousands of people coming forward and sharing their painful experiences, bringing into the light what had been in the darkness. 8,000 women, men and young people recounted their abuse in private sessions with the Royal Commission. A further 1,000 gave written accounts. As well, the Royal Commission received 26,000 letters and emails and 42,000 phone calls. To the thousands who came forward and the thousands who could not, this Parliament said, "We believe you and the country believes you." Our apology didn't and cannot undo our national failures. Nor can an apology return a lost childhood or repair the damage inflicted by the guilty or those who are complicit by their silence. But it can be a marker on a path of healing. Mr. Speaker, this anniversary always requires us to reckon with our past, but it also draws our attention to the present and the very near future. Child sexual abuse is happening now. It's happening online in appalling numbers. The shocking truth is online child sexual abuse was already increasing and it has spiked in response to the COVID-19 restrictions. It makes our response all the more urgent and our resolve all the more unshakable. Our enforcement, intelligence and research agencies are tasked with tracking down child sexual abuse wherever it happens. They work together on many fronts with new and advanced technologies to deter, disrupt and prevent abuse. The Australian Federal Police, the Australian Centre to Counter Child Exploitation and the Australian Border Force are on the front lines. Operation Arkstone is the largest ever domestic investigation into online child sexual abuse. It continues to yield results with more than 1,300 charges laid so far. The Australian Institute of Criminology drives national research to better understand child sexual abuse. The Australian Criminal Intelligence Commission helps law enforcement agencies to respond to online child sexual abuse by linking data sets and using advanced analytics capabilities. And AUSTRAC works with financial institutions to detect and disrupt payments for child abuse materials, including the disgusting practice of abuse that is live streamed. Since 2018, this partnership approach has resulted in an almost 400% increase in reports of suspect financial activity around child exploitation. AUSTRAC and the Australian Border Force have collaborated to harden the Australian border to child sex offenders. And our law enforcement agencies have partnered with the Philippines Financial Intelligence Unit to use information on people arrested overseas to identify previous unknown offenders based in Australia. The Department of Home Affairs is building relationships with digital industry that prevent offenders from using online platforms to groom, exploit, and abuse children or share child abuse material. These and other agencies are working together and with state and territory partners to respond to child sexual abuse. And we continue to work with our five country partners to hold industry to account. Mr. Speaker, we cannot allow our digital environment to offer anonymity and impunity to offenders. It cannot shelter them, nor can we allow it to become a prohibitively hostile and hazardous place for children to be, since so much of their learning and experience depends on being able to enter it safely. All of our children. Mr. Speaker, next week is National Children's Week, a time to celebrate children's achievements and a call to all of us to uphold children's right to enjoy their childhood. Next week, we will launch the National Strategy to Prevent and Respond to Child Sexual Abuse. The National Strategy will be a 10-year whole-of-nation framework to establish a coordinated and consistent approach. It will deliver ambitious and world-leading measures to prevent and respond to all forms of child sexual abuse. In May, I announced a $146 million program over those 4 years for the National Strategy's first phase, including close to $60 million worth of measures to be delivered by the Australian Federal Police. We also committed close to $14 million to equip our intelligence, research and border protection agencies to disrupt the cash flow behind child sexual abuse, to prevent and disrupt live stream child sexual abuse, to intercept material and offenders at the border, and enhance our ability to identify offenders in the community. We also committed over $27 million to support victims and survivors of child sexual abuse, expanding legal assistance to victims and survivors, and co-designing Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander healing approaches. The full national strategy will include additional measures and further funding. My government looks forward to working with the states and territories to deliver these reforms. And finally, Mr. Speaker, at the end of this year, we will table the government's fourth annual progress report against the Royal Commission's recommendations. These yearly reports, as well as the Royal Commission itself and the apology we commemorate today, they are all about accountability. They are about confronting the deepest, darkest secrets in our past and indeed in our present.